Okay, can we all welcome Rob Freeman?
Everybody here? I've got a tendency to move this away from me, Gob, so just give us a shout. So thanks a lot for inviting me. Is this a monthly regular meeting then? I'm going to start from the arm to this morning.
Third Saturday of every month.
Third Saturday? Can't work that out. Send us a text. Yeah, so great presentation by Mark there. Some great stuff there. Funnily enough, your third section, your closing section, was going to be my opening section.
So it's a question.
It segues nicely.
Somebody say something, man. Yeah. Shh. Yeah, your closing section was is my opening section, basically. It's so fantastic to see you again. I've been going to talk for about 2 years, but I've been active. I've been quiet for about a year. Has anybody come across me before? That's not a good thing, is it?
Never seen you before.
You said that.
I'll get rid of you, Rob.
I owe you a pint, so that's all I know. I've been doing stuff a long time. In 2011, a little bit of background, I got on to Get Out of Debt Free. And it was really good because I've been doing stuff for about 2 or 3 years, trying to combat this commerce law thing. Just briefly, because quite a few people have not seen me before.
Oh,
treasure. I ended up having to look after my kids. I think they were aged 6 and 7. I just bought a flipping house. Well, I say bought. Just bought this, got this mortgage, bought this house. And then I'd split up from my missus at the time, and then I had to look after the kids on my own. I thought, oh, right, they're really young, this is going to be difficult. This is probably about 2 or 3 years before 2011 when I got into Get Out of Free. So anyway, they would have either been took into care or I stood up and looked after them, which is what I decided to do. The problem is, the job I had and stuff, the career I was in, I had to finish all that. So I thought, well, someone will turn up. Main thing is to keep me, look after my kids. And then what happened is I had about this much savings and it soon went down. And I thought, oh shit, what am I going to do? I've got a fairly big house, a big mortgage. I don't know what the hell I'm doing, but I've got the kids, what am I going to do? And then just by pure luck, synchronicity as it were, I got a speeding ticket that I kept ignoring at that time because I weren't working, I was shitting myself. I didn't know much. It's probably 2007, something like that. Maybe 8. Anyway, a copper comes to my house one Sunday morning, knocks me up because I've been ignoring him. Usual rubbish. Shows me a photograph of. I probably have the same cap on. I've got now. That's how poor I am. And he went front back. And he goes, is this you? We know that's not me, because this is me. And he's not a flipping photo. And he went, I'm an idiot. I went, yeah, that's me. And he goes, I'm really not paying him. I'm just because I'm fucking skinny. I've got no money. I've got 2 kids to look after. And he felt a bit sorry for me. And he said, just offer him a fiver a week and they'll have to take you. So I thought, brilliant, at least I'm not, I'm ducking and diving, wondering what I'm going to do for money. Is it called a penalty charge notice? Yeah. Anyway, just by pure chance, this bit's valid, this is what got me into everything. Just at the same time, I got a parking ticket from local council. Anyway, he sorts that out, shakes hands with me as he's going. I said, oh, you couldn't help me out with this, could you? He goes, what is it? I said, it's a parking ticket from council. He goes, let's have a look at it. He went, sorry to swear, right? You can hear that bit out. He went, just chucking a bit, it's nothing to do with us. Anyway, when he went, I thought, hey, chucking a bin, can't chuck parking tickets in bin. And that were, I think it were fixed penalty now. What did they call that?
It is a fixed penalty.
Is that from police?
No, it's an intention of prosecution.
Is that from what's parking? Is it a penalty charge?
Okay,
thanks. It's that long ago, I've forgotten. Penalty charge notice from council, fixed penalty notice from police, looked identical. Apart from the logo, they were almost word for word. It is against the law to ignore this and not pay it. So he went, and I kept getting out of the cupboards. A day went past, 2 days, a week went past. I thought, hang on a minute, something's not right here. A police officer or a constable cannot tell you to break the law. And yet, two identical notices are telling me it's against the law, and he's saying, chuck it in the bin. So I'm thinking, he can't tell me. So I thought, well, he can't tell me to break the law. So this must be every bit as valid as his, as theirs. So I thought, well, what is it? It's obviously not law. It can't be law, can it? So if it's not law, that's why he's telling me to throw it away. So if this one's not law, then this one can't be law. And then further research, the first thing I came across is everything's a corporation. Boom, it hit me like that light bulb thing. I was already fairly awake well before this, but I didn't know how to combat this commerce and law thing and courts and stuff. Anyway, cut a long story short, I'm glad then. Cut a long story short, I forgot where I am now. Not that long, yeah. Not that short, is it? Oh yeah, cut a long story short, I was sort of realising, and then early Freeman on the Landship, everyone's slagging them off, but fair credit, I don't know if you agree, Mark, they're the reason why where we are now. Some of their principles and principles that they use and stuff's wrong, and we can't really apply it, but the initial concept of making us into a person, which is a corporation and stuff, is right, and everything else is a corporation. Just waving to someone there. So they corporatise us, haven't they, basically? Anyway, cut a long story short, like I keep saying, I realise that everything's a corporation. Then, I know a little bit about this stuff. If everything's a corporation, then everything's commercial in nature, which thus it's contractual in nature. Now, that's a massive difference to what's the law. How many times have you heard people, Thomas and Bailey's and that say, it's the law. What's the law? Does anybody know what that is? That's been going. What's the law? I don't know what the law is. Ask them to quote it, then they can't do it. Anyway, so from there, I studied everything and I went frantic. I got about 2 hours sleep a night and I learned everything in 10.5 weeks that I could possibly learn as much as I could. And then I started doing a letter system. Mine's not as good as what Get Out Deathly, but at that stage I didn't know what to talk to him. I thought I was mental. Even the kids kept looking at me and going, we should go on to Olivia's mum. Anyway, so I'm questioning myself because I've got no one to talk to. And you know what it's like when you first, you're probably the same, when you first learn, you want to preach to everybody, don't you? And you can see that none of the eyes glaze over when you turn it around. Every time I saw anybody in white, oh, I thought he'd come in for me. Like, but it only lasted a little bit, because after 10 and a half weeks, I realised that that I was on the right track. So, the whole thing, there's so many fantastic people doing great work and... Alvin Starks from something. I'm not about sweating or drowning. If you're just splashing something, I'll piddle myself. Right, just keep telling me if I love it. Where was I? Oh, he's got
this one.
That's where I want, that's where I went. Yeah, so 10.5 weeks later, go blah, blah, blah. Start sending letters. Oh, realised that name. So, oh, that's it. Lots of people are doing fantastic stuff, aren't they? It's really complicated. It's all great. Anybody who stands up and does something, fair play. I don't care whether you win, lose, or draw, it doesn't matter. Everyone's standing up and doing something fantastic. For me, I've got a really sharp mind. I don't think so, looking at me, would you? But I've got a really sharp, quick mind. I haven't got many gifts, but one gift I have got is to take something really complicated and simplify it, because I am just a bloke off the street. And what I realised is the first step, no matter what, is all in that name. That name, whether it's capitalised, or, and I'm sure most people know this, or it's got a title of Mr, Mrs, Ms, and Ms, whatever it is, it's not us. And from that one standpoint, everything else for me has fell into place and gone away a long time ago. And like I say, I sent my letter, sent him a backup letter, and then basically just told to do one. And then in 2011, I did it with everything. The only bill I pay now, eligible, is the mortgage. And I tried it in 2011 and I got into some serious shit. And that's, I probably did my first ever post on Get Out of Debt Free. And I don't know if you can remember, Mark, it got massive. People looked at it. And what it were is, the whole basis of everything was that there's no contract in place. Remember I said everything's contractual? I keep talking to just you two. This is our family, isn't it? I don't know, I'm mesmerised with you two, I don't know what it is. Like a, you know, a couple, aren't you? Sorry, can edit that bit. Yeah, so I realised everything's contractual in nature, everything's a contract. So, that name is not ours. Ours. You've all seen that? Pathetic attempt at a birth certificate. It even says, don't it, this is not to be used as identity, and it even says Crown Copywriter. So we know that that name, whether it's, if it's all capitalised or it's Mr. or Mrs. with the title, it's not us. So if it's not us, it can't be a contract in place. And I'm sure every single one of you, you have a look at any Any demand placed upon you by, via a letter, whether it's financial or from a court or from a police officer, whatever it is, every single perceived obligation of yours will always come either in a capitalised name or with a title, Mr. Mrs. whatever. That's not us. You know, my mum and dad didn't call me Mr. Rothman, did they? And they certainly didn't like my birthday cards with capital letters, did they? So we know it's not us. And from that point on, everything else is kind of irrelevant. If you can stick down and try tricks, they'll try absolutely everything. It's so, the unbelievable, it's a fantastic system, isn't it? But there's no contract in place. So, okay, people say the law, and we don't know what the law is. I would actually talk a little bit about something called tort, T-O-R-T. Is anybody familiar with tort? Oh, no, I need to talk about it then, are they? Yeah, I'll go on a little bit about it. Anyway, so, this is going somewhere, honestly. I'm going to talk about council tax a little bit. So, there's either a crime or some piece of legislation, which we know are acts and statutes, yeah? The crime is where somebody's been harmed, like Mark was talking about in his presentation. Somebody's been harmed, so we know that's a crime. Well, there has to be somebody living, a man or woman or a child or whatever, to step forward and say, I've been harmed. Okay, it might seem a little long-winded, but this is really important, this, because, as Mark will tell you, they try and say that any infraction of the statute is a crime. Driving offences and stuff like this, that they're crimes. Well, they can't be a crime because there's no injured party. So for something to be a crime, it has to have three elements, and all three elements have to be in place. Actus reus, I think that's how you pronounce it, that's the actual act of doing something. Mens rea is the second element, which is a guilty mind. You've got to know that you're doing wrong. And then the third, I think it's corpus delicti, which is an injured party. So all three things have got to be in place for a crime, yeah? Any one of those missing, and it's not a crime. So if it's not a crime, number copper, in fact, 22B, if it's not a crime, then it has to be an infraction of a statute, legislation, some ruling, some government rule. Every single government rule part of the legal system applies to that name that's not us. Yeah? Which then comes back to being a civil matter. It's not a crime, it's a civil matter. It ain't, because there's a tort stuck in there, I'll tell you that in a bit. So just for now, crime or civil matter?
Okay.
How many people think you can be locked up for not paying council tax? No one thinks you can be locked up for not paying council tax.
Brilliant.
You think you can? Some people have been locked up, haven't they?
Yeah, they have.
Okay, I'll. So bear in mind everything that's civil is contractual. But they're not contracting our lowercase names, they're contracting in. A title name that don't belong to us, but similar to ours. So there's not even a contract in place, is there? So I just want to, I'll hand this around. You can just get this off a judicial website, just type in the block. What is a judicial website? Can you remember here? It's got loads of W's to start with and the dot. I think it's just, yeah, just .gov.uk. Anyway, this particular section is magistrates, magical administrators only. I'm going to have to put my stupid glasses on, which I sat on last night, late on. I've got flipping sellotape on now. Okay, so we can get on this and just have a look at it. So anyone who thinks, or is anybody not paying council tax, by the way?
I don't pay it.
Brilliant. I've never paid it, even when I didn't know what I would have never paid it. So just go on that judicial website. It's there, look for magistrates, just click on it. Scroll down, I think it's just after youth offenders. There's a little section there, and it says magistrates civil. Most crimes, if it is a proper crime, it starts off at magistrates and then gets sent to Crown. But this is the role of magistrates civil. And it says, although most magistrates deal with criminal work, they also decide many civil matters, okay, so it's contractual in nature, particularly in relation to family work. This bit here, magistrates civil roles include dealing with cases such as non-payment of council tax. And there it is on their website. I just want to hand that round to everyone to keep on, just to show that I haven't made it up. So, council tax, brilliant. It can't be a crime, so you can't get locked up. So that's a good thing, isn't it? At least you can do, I keep that. If anybody ever comes and says don't, you just give them that. So it's a civil matter anyway. So that's one good thing. I went off the tour. I went to have done council tax. I've gone there. So I mean, I'm thicker, aren't I?
Sure that money off, man.
It's just a flipping junk off the ticket. Maybe I'm sweating here.
For once.
Nice breakfast, that is. So I've been asked to do a little bit I've been really quiet for about a year, and people just keep sending emails, what do you do for council tax, what do you do for... They're horrible, aren't they? Council tax, Department of Work and Pensions...
Taxman.
All horrible people, aren't they? Utilities, gas and electric, horrible people. So they're the worst ones, and driving. I always tell people, stay away from all that. And they're probably the first ones I ever did, so... Okay, so I keep getting messages, emails and Skype messages, what do you do for council tax? I keep saying to people, well, I can only tell you what I do, and everyone can do it differently, but it's all based on that number one thing of that name's not us, so there's no contract in place. So I think you were back in 2009 or 10. I never paid the bills anyway, because they're not bills, are they? But I just used to duck and dive and not know what I'm doing. Anyway, I've got a demand for this bill, whatever. So I did that letter thing, that's really great, we'll get that debt free. And I just said, one thing is that I've never refused to pay anything or do anything if a judge... I once sent back altogether 5 judges' orders and just sent them back. Any demand that's placed on me, I've never, ever, ever refused to do it, not once. And I think this is why I don't get dragged to court. I only ever went to court for a laugh at one time. I never actually got dragged there. Or did I got arrested once over a driving offence? I got arrested 4 times over the same driving offence. But anyway, apart from getting kidnapped in there, I don't go to court. Oh, it's not cool enough anymore, is it?
It's your age, Rob.
Who said that? Only because you're a bit younger. You'll get there, mate. So that's where I went, huh?
Council tax.
So council tax. So, I never refuse it. And what I do is I accept whatever they're saying or placing any demand on me, I accept it. If it's a loan, for instance, you owe us £5,000 or whatever, or council tax you owe us £1,000, I accept it. I might owe it you, but I accept it on a condition, sometimes called conditional acceptance. It's conflict that takes you to court. It's arguing. They want you to argue. Has anybody ever sent a letter or a notice and you've got a reply saying thank you for your letter of complaint? Has anybody had that?
Oh yeah, it's
scandals. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly, they want us in conflict. That's what takes you to court. They need you in conflict.
Tone of voice, you open a complaint.
Pardon?
If somebody's tone of voice changes, I work for the power industry.
Okay.
If somebody's tone of voice on the phone tells you they're not happy, then the procedure is to open a complaint.
So that's across the board, isn't it? They want you in a complaint, don't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, fantastic.
Just a tone of voice. Even if a customer says they don't want you to raise a complaint,
right,
you still have to raise them a grievance. There has to be a note of that.
So they want us in complaint because they want us... they want us in conflict, and that's what lawyers are. That's why lawyers are so good and get paid so much, because they argue. So based on that fact, I realised this really early on, so no conflict from me. So council tax, you owe us £1,000. Okay, I may owe it you, I don't think I do, to be honest. So I'll go and pay it, I'll go and pay it tomorrow, I'll go and get money out. I won't take the skin, but they don't know that. I'll go tomorrow and I'll go and pay it. I accept I may owe you £1,000, you're saying I owe this tax, whatever it is, to council. Do me a favour, I do accept it, but I've got some condition of my own. My conditions are, show me that there's a contract in place. Don't send me the original, just send me a copy of the original that says that we've both signed it and I agreed to pay it and I'll go and pay it. It's not in my name, is it? It's that legal fiction horrible name that couldn't belong to me. So they can never provide a contract. So I ask for that, and I also say to them, second thing for council tax, this is what I'm coming to, this is what I've done. Send me a bill. You keep sending me invoices and statements, but you never send me a bill. Never once have you sent me a bill. It has to be signed, doesn't it? Bills are exchange. If I come and paint your bathroom and I say, it's £100, you say send me a bill, I'm going to write on it and I'm going to sign on to it because it's a valid bill in law then. So show me a copy of the contract that we both signed, not even original, just show me a copy. And send me a proper bill, send me a bill, not a statement. It's like if if me and Bob go out for something to eat and I'm paying for it, I don't shout, wait to another statement. Well, that was, send an invoice, mate, I've got to pay for it, I've got to have a bill. Pardon?
Can I have a demand, please?
Say again?
Can I have a demand?
Or final demand.
Yeah, so we know it's not a bill. So, they don't do it, do they? So then I write back to them and say, I'm labouring this a bit, aren't I? I might as well be paid it, it would have been easier. I asked the contract, asked for a proper bill, they don't send it. I then give them another few days. I said, look, I may owe this money, I don't think I do. Just show me a bit of proof and I'm going to pay it. Then it comes again, they don't do it again. And it goes on, not very long. I think I probably used to do it for a while. I don't do this stuff anymore, by the way. This is how I've arrived at what I have. I think it's usually about, I don't know, 10 years or like 2.5 weeks, 3 weeks, and it's all done. And then I said, this is what I was doing before I got onto the Get Out Debt Free site. And then I just send them the stuff, saying, look, I've given you a chance, I'll give you time, I'll give you this. I can't, I'm not talking. I'm standing here, I'm not talking to you two anymore now. So, yeah, I don't know why I keep looking at you. Do you want to watch him?
I look away.
Sorry. I once got fixated by a really expensive chandelier when I was doing a tour, and I just threw a bobble up my heart for about 5 minutes. And I thought I cracked up. Yeah, so I've had enough. There's no contract in place, there's no bill. I've asked for it, I've asked for it again, I've asked for it a third time. Actually, I've had enough. I then sent to my. I said, look, if you're going to send me any more stuff, this is what I'm going to charge you now, because it's just getting past the joke. I'm a busy man, I've got loads to do. And then I put that. £1,000 a letter, £1,000 a message. If anyone comes to my house, £3,000 per person per visit. And I just sent that off to them. Anyway, as always happens, they never respond to it. And like Mark was saying earlier, that's an agreement. It's tacitly agreeing. They agreeing to it.
Stop.
Yeah, I didn't call it that though, because I did all this before I got on to Get Out of Free, which is obviously a better system than mine. But I was there because this is what I was doing. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because this is set up where I'm at now. Anyway, so they don't send anything. So it's left at that. What did I do? Oh, I put £50 a day interest on my schedule of fees, basically. So I know that every time a little week goes by, if you don't send me out, it's going up. And so when I learned this whole game, this whole contractual fictional bollocks that it is, is I thought, and I keep getting, every time I do a talk on YouTube, I always get somebody commenting, you're a dickhead, you're not paying out, you think it's clever. And, alright, they're entitled to their own opinion, but the scam, oh, that's what I forgot to mention earlier, the scam is that none of us are paying for anything anyway. That when I was struggling with my kids, I would either feed them stupid corporations or feed my kids. Well, I want to look after my kids, aren't I? And then I realised that it's United Kingdom Corporation is bankrupt. I think it's in chapter 22 bankruptcy. Debtors in possession, which means that none of us are paying. All we're doing is deferring it to a late. It's promised to pay. That we never get fulfilled. And just because I can sort, you know, I can get 5 drinks for £10, I think I'm paying for it. But it's not. It's just the paperwork's balancing up and zeroing it out because I'm in a state of bankruptcy. So none of us are paying for anything, which is a bit crazy, isn't it? So there is no money. So once I realised that, then I really got going. So for them people that do answer on YouTube and say you're a dickhead, you don't pay them that, I am a dickhead, but none of us pay anyway. So what's it matter? If I had the pretend money, the monopoly money to give them, I'd give it them just for a quiet life, but I've got it. So so what happened is then, everything every year an automated, I get off this council task, don't you? Every year, in about end of March, an automated an automated pretend bill. I hit that, two bunny rabbits. I hit that pretend bill came, and all I do is send it back. I got onto a website. The very first week I started doing it, I got onto a website, and it was supposed to be a council worker whistleblower. I won't give his name. And what he said is, the council can't move forward if you return that so-called bill. Return it to them. Right, so that's what I started doing at first, just returning the bill. But then, as we know, a summons comes. And at first, I was returning summons to magistrates' courts in my town. I thought, hang on a minute, they're still moving ahead, or they're still threatening. So I thought magistrates' court up. Next time I got a summons, and I said, you know, is there a listing for me? And they went, no. And obviously we know now that the summons comes from the council, doesn't it? So, the process is, every year I get an automated pretend bill in end of March, beginning of April. first pretend bill goes back to the council. My council now, in Derbyshire, is using a PO box right down south, so that when you send stuff back, anyway, wherever it comes from, I send it back. Pretend bill goes straight back to them. Summons, mistake they used to make, goes back to the council, not to the court, nothing to do with court. They just have a big bumming pad and stamping away. That's why there's no listing for me, because they don't even know they've got about 1,000 foot morning, haven't they? It's ridiculous. So, pretend bill straight back to them, summons straight back to them, and then what you'll get next is some letters saying we have got our liability over. Wow, I'll have a look at definition liability over that. Opens up a whole field of flipping research that was. But anyway, that letter then, that everything that comes from that council goes back to them.
The liability order as well?
It's not a liability order, it's notification that they've received a liability order. You ask them to see a copy of that liability order, you'll never see it. I don't know anybody who's seen it, do you?
No.
I don't know anybody. So everything goes back to them.
I've got one.
Pardon?
I've got one.
Have you got a liability order?
Supposed to be a liability
order. Is there a signature on the bottom? That's interesting now.
Supposed to be a liability order.
Very interesting. Is it signed? Well, I could have really knocked it up on computer and brought it for you. Look at it. Okay, this liability order. Okay, it's got lots of typing, lots of words, lots of bold. Brilliant. Justice of the Peace typed in, and it's got a signature. Okay. Does anybody know what that name? Do you know what that name says? Do you know what the name says? You don't, do you?
And the court said they don't know nothing about it.
Oh, fantastic. So somebody, the council has put that together, hasn't it? Brilliant, thanks. So thus back into what I'm saying. There's a signature on it, but you can't make out the name. Usually it's a name, but no signature, so they've gone the other way there. Yeah. The point to it is, that's supposed to be just for the piece. But you can't identify the name.
It's all fraud.
It's all fraud. Thanks for that. Just proving your point.
So they're trying to impersonate Justice of the Peace, and that's fraud.
Well, there's certain legislation that's allowing them to do it. They're only together, as we know. So it's all an arrangement between the judiciary, the executive, the law, the councils, all these different institutions, even police to a certain extent, not all of them. So it's all fraud, don't you know? So that's what happened. Last bit on this, but I want to get some better stuff for us. So I've got them in this agreement where they've accepted my charges and stuff, so that's brilliant. And so every three or four months I send them a bill just to combat that pretend bill that they're sending. Okay, so last 3 minutes on this. In 2013, December 2nd, I got a letter from this woman on this council. It was a new position in the council. I think they've ramped it up, step the game up. Concentric Service Manager. Concentric Service Manager. Oh,
really?
Everyone's gone to queue. We've cost me glasses before. Concentric Service Manager. Anyway, you owe us blah, blah, blah. If you don't pay up within 7 days, I'm going to go for a committal to prison. Oh, alright. Interesting. I don't know about people getting locked up, Roger Hayes and people like that, so I thought, oh, this is interesting. I've got a friend called Hotep, she lives in London now, this touched me now. She thinks I'm a tosser because I've not contacted her, but I hope she's watching this after because I'll make contact. She gave me a great idea that I don't think, apart from myself and me, I don't think anyone else has done this. And the reason I'm mentioning this is what's 100% saved me now. No one's ever been to my house or council tax in all these years. Whenever a corporation places a demand on you, if you're not happy, I think most of us who communicate by go straight for the CEO, don't we? It's best to go straight for usually the CEO is the top person in that organisation. So the lower staff are giving me some grief in any corporation, I'll write straight to the CEO because they're the top man. So I look at my council, I look at the constitution, and I thought, well, hang on a minute. It's the only industry that I know where the CEO is not the top man. Sharing the same office space, by the way, do you know the word office? One definition is an ecclesiastical space, meaning ecclesiastical church, very interesting. I thought, hang on a minute, CEO is not the top man in this particular case. He is, but there's somebody slightly above him. And what I noticed is the Lord Mayor shares the same office space and the same building as the CEO, as the head of, mine's the Borough Council, the Borough Council. And this is, my friend Hotep gave me this idea. So what I did is I looked at the oath that the Lord Mayor in my town swears and I can't remember it now, it's quite a few years ago, well, 2013. He swears an oath to do right by all manner of people in the borough. Not persons, in that corporate legal sense, people. I thought... My opinion is that the clergy, the parishes, and the whole thing, the whole system of corporations goes right back to the Vatican in Rome. That, in my opinion, from my thousands of hours of research and a few of my friends, I know that they're calling the shots and everything's subservient underneath there. I've got a thing called Monte Proprio to share at the end. And I've been using that since the 1st of March 2012, ish, end of the estimate, 2013. And it scares the shit out of me. That's how I know the Vatican's running stuff. Anyway, the Lord Mayor's position is an ecclesiastical position. Parishes, centuries ago, used to look after the people in the borough, and the oaths never changed. So, with a bit of help from, with an idea from my friend Holter, I sent this, and I'll hand this round. I've just changed a couple of personal details off. Okay, so, Mayor's Parlour, same building as the CEO of the town hall in my town. Dear Mr. Mayor, you have this day, 16th of January 2014, so it's a couple of weeks after, this is me sending it to him, being identified as a party of interest in relation to the matter here at hand. Please find here attached a copy of the correspondences that are currently being exchanged between the parties today, namely me and council, name my tacit agreement and all that stuff. These documents I send to you are out of honour and courtesy for your convenience and prior consideration, so that you may be provided with forewarning should I be forced to name you as a defendant in any court action that I am subsequently given to be involved in. So basically what I'm saying is, I'm holding him to his oath. There's a corporation that haven't got a contract in place and that aren't sending me a bill that are threatening now to have me kidnapped and locked up, when I'm sending them my bill, which is just as valid, and they're not paying it. So I'm now calling on the oath of the Lord Mayor to come and to protect one of his people in the borough. Should I get dragged into court, he's going to be my defendant. I'm dragging him as a defendant on for my behalf. Never heard a thing like shit himself. Never heard any communication since.
Hello.
It gets better. Listen to this. I love this. Okay. So I don't get, that time comes and goes. What date's on this? This is now 11th March 2015. Nothing's happened. Once I sent that pretend liability order, I've never heard a thing. So I keep sending my bills every now and again. I send him another bill. Okay, this is fantastic. I've just took my personal this. I'm going to hand this round so you have very much to look at. Okay, head of the legal department in the council is a chap called Stephen Oliver. So I sent my latest bill in sometime in January 2015. Okay, Stephen Oliver, their legal expert, their top man in the whole council, the man who calls the shots, sends me a three-line letter back. You're going to love this. Oh, by the way, I sign everything in the middle if I put a signature on it. Stephen Oliver, copying what I do, has put his signature right in the slap in the middle. One side's debtors, apparently, one side's creditors. Slapping, almost slapping middle, trying to disguise it so he copied what I did. He put... I sent something on 3rd of February, and this is 11th of March reply. He's edited correspondence dated 3rd of February 2015. I write further to your letter dated 3rd of February 2015. So this is him replying to my letter. Get this. I confirm that the council will not be paying your bill. Okay, I'm just going to read you that again. This is head of their legal, their top man, is now confirming, look at the words he's chosen to use. I confirm that the council will not be paying your bill. Interesting, mate. If you are unsure as to your position, you should seek independent legal advice. That's him to me. As soon as I got it, I think the business owners are laughing at much. And then I grabbed a pad and scribbled. I'll tell you the significance of that. I don't know anything else was happening to them. So I reply really quickly, probably the day after. Dear Stephen Oliver, thank you for your letter dated 11th of March, blah, 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 which was in response to my letter, blah, blah, blah. Oh, and thank you for using my correct, uncopyrighted name of Rob Freeman. Okay. The letter he sent me came in the lowercase name that I wanted, not the Mr. and not the capitalised, so something's happening, isn't it? Okay, so my response to the council will not be paying your bill. Thanks for using my uncopyrighted name of Rob Freeman. I put, thank you for confirming both points that the Borough Council will not be paying my bill. And by calling it your bill, which he did, in said letter, that it is indeed recognised by you as being a valid bill. He's now put down on paper that he's recognised what I'm sending them is a valid bill. Game over, what can they ever do? Everything's, remember it's civil, everything's contractual in nature. Blah, blah, blah. And by calling it your bill, in said letter that it is indeed recognised by you as being a valid bill. Said council has never once produced a valid bill to me. Enforcement of my bill, now I can call it a bill because he's called it a bill, yeah. And he's their top man. Enforcement of my bill, which remains unpaid today, will continue to be processed until I receive a written acknowledgement from the CEO of said council, as described in my previous letter. Okay, I've asked him to wipe it out and promise not to do anything again. And that's it. So, I'll have that round because I don't want to take it long. If anybody just wants to look at it,
there's
just
the other one, gone. Somebody's got to read it.
So state on now is that every year an automated pretend bill comes, like I said, every year it goes back. Pretend someone comes, every year it goes back. They send me a notification, I don't get the liability order, but we have obtained the liability order. In fact, phone the magistrate's call and see if the liability order has gone through.
I've been three times.
No record of it?
No record of it.
There you go, thank you.
They don't deal with it in magistrate court. So that's enough city council. They have their own legal, it's just says.
So I think on the advice of an equivalent of Stephen Oliver, that's what they're doing. Well, he's just seriously messed up, hasn't he? He never contact me directly, all that is automated, and they just get sent back. So to not doing bad from December 2013, you've got 7 days, look where we are now, and he's coming. And let's think about it. That what Mark was saying in his presentation, Mark Devlin, about a universal type law. This has always been my standpoint. They either manufacture it or trick you into consent. They somehow bend it so that we're consenting without realising, aren't we? And that's because we're not in the full facts and they're tricksters, aren't we? I don't know why I made that point. I think it's early Alzheimer's kicking in. I don't even drink like that. Anyway, the point to it is they need your consent, don't they? So we know it's contractual, we know it's civil. And so all that could ever happen, this is the point we're getting to, all that can happen is, if I ever did get kidnapped and dragged in, one, I've got a right to adjourn it and bring Lord Mayor in, but because it's not a crime, remember I said it's civil, well all civil is contractual, it has to be, there has to be a contract, there has to be some form, whether they trick you into it, which is consent, or not. Think about what could they ever really do to me? I've got a valid bill, even they're admitting it's a valid bill. I think last one I sent was 63,000 because of the interest and I keep advising them to seek independent legal advice. I do. And I keep saying to them, if you pay within 7 days, I'll not. Oh, that's another good thing. I always offer them a reduction. I'll knock you 20% off. But I know I advise them. I haven't brought bills. Well, I might have done. But if anybody wants them, I'll give them you. I'll send them you. I keep telling them, look, you're getting seriously into fucking trouble here. You're claiming you've got no money.
And the baby's in.
You're into, you know, I'm into you for 63,000, it's going up 50 quid a day, and you've agreed to it and you've called it a bill. I mean, what more do you want that you're in serious trouble? Do you know what I'm saying? You really ought to think about your position, and I'm willing, you know, I'm open to negotiation, I'll knock 20% off straight away if you want to pay me straight away. Anyway, and I got the better way of doing bills from Get Out of Debt Free. Well, if I imagine it's a cornetto, it's going to be a bill. It's happening, that's all right. Yeah, and I've got a great way of doing the bills better from the market free, so if you're not already on it, I presume you know, but again, and for people on the video, get on that fantastic site. So that's the council tax, so I'm not worried at all, I mean, no, you can't block to. So that's the council tax shit. You don't have to do what I do, just do your own thing, do what feels right, that's what I did. But seriously think about that Lord Mayor thing, because they have to protect you, and that's brilliant. So you can you, or we try and hold judges, don't we, and police officers to their oath. It's the same thing, really. Never heard a squeak from him, never heard a kick from him. So, that's council tax, what's that? What I'm going to do, if it's alright, is do an hour, have a little break, because your answers must be killing you now. have a break for 25 minutes and then I'll make the last bit not too long, so you don't have to take it too long. Right, so that's the council tax that somebody wanted me to talk about. Oh, right, okay. Oh, this is good, son.
I'm not telling
you that. Oh, I'll give you this. Right, I'll tell you a quick story, but I'll make it quick this time. My story's longer than my nose, if that's possible. Longer than a DFS sale. 3 years ago, I started helping somebody who were getting bullied at work. And then they got signed off from the doctor. And this incorporates all this stuff, and this is how I've learned what I've learned, especially this last year and a half, 2 years. Anyway, this is 3 years ago. They got bullied, they made a complaint. They did a pretend inquiry, excuse me. A pretend grievance investigation. Found out there weren't enough evidence. My friend got signed off, suffering from anxiety and depression. Excuse me. Cough. Before long, after a few weeks had passed, they tried to terminate his employment, and that's it, his career's gone. This were all for daring to raise an issue, basically. So what happened is, because he's really close to me, like a brother, I've been with him right from, I think, the first 3 weeks I got signed off, I've been helping him, and I've been responding. We went on for ages, we asked for all sorts of stuff. We asked for the bond details, we asked for absolutely all sorts. And we refused, we non-consented to them terminating his employment. And so now he keeps sending in, this has gone on now for 3.5 years, and he's still sending his fit notes, he's still sending them in, and they're still keeping them. Anyway, we finally filed for court about 14 months ago in High Court. And me, like a pillock, because I didn't know what I was doing, before we filed for court, I didn't realise that you filed for court, and then there's a process and you put your case together, all your evidence. Like a numpty, I put the whole flipping case together, every bit, exhibit fucking 574,000. I did the whole thing thinking that when I filed, we'd give them the whole case. I didn't know, I'm not a lawyer. But by doing it wrongly and in reverse order, you're supposed to arrive at that point after you start the process. Because of their reactions, I now know something really significant from doing this friend's case. And I've just been talking to a chap who used to work for the fire service, and I did it on a radio show 2 weeks ago, and since I filed, this is what I've really come across. And what I found out is, there's something called health and safety, which we all know about, yeah? Wow. From doing this, and especially this last 14 months, I've been helping people using health and safety, and we've been killing people here. Same as that legal bloke who didn't know what to say. Stunned, they don't know what to do. So everybody's heard of health and safety, yeah? Yeah? Anybody not heard of it? Well, how many people think it's a tool for them to make money, isn't it? You've got to have a license for this, permission for that, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so how many people think it's just for, and it doesn't matter if you're wrong, I'm always wrong. How many people think it's for employees to be safeguarded from employers? Yeah, and that's what I'd have thought, and I'm one of them. And I thought that's all it were. Which just makes sense, doesn't it? Okay, you're going to love this, because I loved it. I was so excited. I talked to my great friend Rob B about this. Does anybody know Rob B? Top man.
Yeah.
I did a radio show with him, and I lost a bit of touch with him. I told him about this, we were jumping for joy, and we're back on again next week. Rob used to be in military, I think, and I think he's some sort of civil engineer now. Something like that. So he knows all about health and safety. Anybody I know that used health and safety previous to this, as regard health and safety as being under the umbrella of law, which you think it would be. The law's the top thing. One part underneath it is health and safety, the valid part. But what I've realised is health and safety is not under the law, it's above any law possible. There is no law that any man can write that's above health and safety. And going back to Mark's presentation earlier, health and safety is mirroring of do no harm. Okay, so I got into this, and it might sound a bit convoluted, you might think, mate, it's bollocks. It's not. I'll show you this. There's an act from 1974 that's not changed, when health and safety started getting really big. Where is it? Okay, get this. If anybody's into going through the legislation, which I was, I know Rob B is, let me know, I'll give you my email at the end, if you've ever heard of an act titled like this. So this is the Act from 1974 that's never changed. Health and Safety at Work, etc. Act 1974. I'm just going to read that again. Health and Safety at Work, which is what you'd expect, etc. Act 1974. Just put it off the internet while I said it. I thought, what the fucking was, etc. Is it a typo? So I checked everything, judicial websites. No, it's not. Okay, this act, and it's massive, and there's so much to it, but if you want to make a note of it, or contact me later, have a look at sections 237 and 37. This is what I've been using. And I've been helping people, and we've been killing people on it. 237 and 37. I'll just read you preliminary. That's that word. Preliminary. Okay, preliminary. The provisions of this part shall have effect with a view to A. Securing the health, safety and welfare of persons at work, which is what we expected. B. I've done it in red, so I'm going to hand it around and see it. Protecting persons other than persons at work against risk to health or safety arising out of or in connection with the activities of persons at work. I'm just going to read that again. Protecting persons other than persons at work. This is for all corporations, remember. Protecting persons other than persons at work against risk to health or safety. Not health and safety, health or safety. Arising out of or in connection with the activities of persons at work. What that's saying is, health and safety, the corporation has got an obligation for health and safety to its employees, but to other people that aren't employees of that corporation. Etc. So I started digging. Interested. Section 3. So it's 237 and 37. And I've written it, like I said. General duties of employers and self-employed to persons other than their employees. It shall be the duty of every employer to conduct his undertaking in such a way as to ensure, so far as reasonably practicable, that persons not in his employment who may be affected thereby are not thereby exposed to risk to their health or safety. So it's telling you there in section 3. And again it says, it shall be the duty of every self-employed person, so whether you're self-employed or not a big corporation, it still applies to you, that he and other persons not being his employees who may be affected thereby or not thereby exposed to risk to their health or safety. So even if you're self-employed and you're not a corporation, you're still under an obligation to people that don't work for you. Okay. Only a little bit on this and I'll show you where it's going. Oh, that's interesting. Extension of time for bringing summary proceedings. So if somebody reaches health and safety, the last line is, excuse me, the offence shall be deemed to continue until that thing is done. So in other words, if they breach health and safety, if they don't put it right, it continues. There's no time limit on it if you keep doing it. This all makes sense, isn't it? Pardon? No, not if you've not put it right. They've got a certain level of time to put it right, and if they don't, which they won't, it's ongoing and continuing, which will be important when we get to it. Okay. I'll just read these two more sections and I'll tell you how I've implemented it, doing my friend's case, and now how I'm using it to help other people. Okay. I'll read it, it's a bit boring, but I'll read it. In such cases may be prescribed, it shall be the duty of every employer and every self-employed person in the prescribed circumstances, yeah, and in the prescribed manner, yeah, to give to persons not being his employees who may be affected by the way in which he conducts his undertaking. The prescribed information about such aspects of the way in which he conducts his undertaking as might affect their health or safety. So what I'm saying is, whether it's a self-employed person or a corporation, whatever he undertakes to do, it might affect their... Now that's important. It doesn't say that somebody who's not an employee affects their health or safety, health and safety, health or safety, that might affect their health. So that led me to think, can you always throw one word in, don't they? You think, shit, I thought I understood it, and then you just throw might in. So what does might employ? What does might imply? It implies that you've still got rights as a non-employee against a corporation whose undertaking may affect your health or safety. Doesn't have to actually do you any damage. It may affect, and that's when I got into it. And that just that one word did it. I'm just reading this last section, I'll explain it. I don't have to break it off. Offences by body corporate, section 37. It must be put, it's long, but it must be put because I put it in red, so I'll read it. Where an offence under any of the relevant statutory provisions, right? Whether an offence under any of the relevant statutory provisions, any part of that massive act that a body corporate was wrong, anything, okay? Any of the relevant statutory provisions committed by a body corporate is proved, this is the bit that we're using from a friend, is proved to have been committed with the consent or connivance of, or to have been attributable to any neglect on the part of any director, manager, secretary, or other similar officer of the body corporate, or a person who is purporting to act in such a capacity, and this is the bit I want to get to, he as well as the body corporate shall be guilty of that offence, and shall be liable to be proceeded against and punished accordingly. Long way of saying, you know. So, anybody who pretends to be an officer, or is an officer, or even pretends to be, or works for that corporation, not only is the corporate body, the corporation, liable, whoever it is, the CEO, imagine you're the CEO, and I'm a director or something, and I cause harm from health and safety, you then become vicariously liable for my actions, because you're top man. So that's health and safety, right. So, I started thinking, hang on a minute now, so it says health or safety. And this is how we started killing people. For my friend's case in High Court, we've already been one, so they keep delaying it. And I've been wanting to go on radio shows and talk about this, but we've won the case with some other elements I'm going to tell you after break. We've actually won the case, but they won't submit to and give it us. And they're like stringing it out like they do. So we've been once, we're going back in October, and then it'll probably carry on all the way through to about March next year. And then they'll finally give us the result that we know we've already got. And I don't know if you've come across this, Mark, they make us wait, don't they, before. They don't just cave in, do they? So, one massive strong element of this is the health and safety. The other, which I'm going to talk about after the break, is tort, which we're using. Remember when I said there's a crime, there's legislation. So, that's a crime, and I described the elements to you. That's legislation which is basically contractual in nature. But somewhere over and along there is something called tort, leaning a bit more towards crime. So, a real brief example of tort. I'll finish off on tort. Do you want to finish off, sorry, on the health and safety, and I'll have a break. So what's tort? Okay. So you either commit a crime or you break some statutory rule. But hang on a minute. Imagine having, and I use this analogy because I don't think about this. Imagine having a garden party in my garden, 50 people, and we're all having a drink. And imagine I start swinging a shovel around. And imagine I just catch someone back at Edward. Have I committed a crime? Anybody think I've committed a crime? I don't have a. And that men's right, I've not gone up and purposely with intent smacked him on the head, so I've not done that. God, is it that crap? Everyone's leaving. I've not seen any statute that says I can't swing a shovel around in the garden, but somebody's been harmed, haven't they? Remember, they do no harm, they're supposed to harm. There must be some sort of remedy for that person who's been harmed. That's where tort comes in. So tort is, basically, it's negligence. Okay. As far as corporations, and when we do the little bit after the break, you'll see where this is going, because this is what it's all accumulated from this case and what I'm putting together. And it sounds complicated, but there's about four elements. Once you get to grips with them, you'll kill anybody with it. Tort is a wrongdoing. Okay, the only remedy for tort is financial compensation. You see them adverts, have you had a trip or fall anywhere, and you've walked along, haven't you? You just know it's going to fall, don't you? And then somebody gets run over and he stabbed himself in the eye. But that's negligence, that's a tort, somebody's left something out for safety again. A tort, for a tort to be valid, and remember, by the way, the tort is nothing to do with contract. So for instance, if I work for you, the employment contract that we've got between us, if you commit a wrongdoing through being negligent, it's got nothing to do with that working contract, it's separate. Okay? which is really important because...
So I can't put a disclaimer?
You can't fire me. There might be something in my employment contract that the only way I can go against an officer with a complaint is to go down a grievance procedure, for instance. And if I don't do that, then you might have given your rights to the contract to sack me. A talk is separate from the contract. So for a talk to be successful, you've got to have three elements, a bit like that crime. One, you've got to show that there's a duty of care. Two, you've got to show that somebody's breached that duty. And the third bit, and the important bit, is to show that somebody suffered harm as a result of that breach.
Okay.
Sounds complicated, it's dead easy, really. So I'm swimming ashore around, aren't I? I've invited these people to my house, I've got a duty of care, haven't I? We've all got a duty of care to each other, haven't we?
Yeah.
You know, if I'm bending over, Mark can't just rub me and kick me up the arse, can't, well, he can, but it's not right, is it? You know what I mean? It's not got a nice arse.
Test it later.
Well, that was your thought. So we've all got a duty of care to each other. That's why we don't just walk up to someone and shout at them, we're like, oh, hello, nice to meet you. It's only later on things get on, but you've got a duty of care to each other, haven't you? So we can establish that. So when I'm swinging a shovel around in my garden, I've got a duty of care to other people. Did I breach that duty of care? Yes, I did. There's a good chance I'm going to hurt someone if I'm swinging a shovel around, isn't it? And did somebody get harmed as a result of that breach? Yes, somebody's got smacked back at head. So with that in mind, I've known about talk for a long time. Halsbury's talk, if you want to look at Halsbury's talk, I've got volumes really. So marrying that together with health and safety, according to the Health and Safety Act, etc., 1974, Health and Safety at Work Act, it says that you only have to be put, and this is the real key to it before we have a break, this is the key to everything that I'm doing. It says in the Act that you only have to be placed in a potential risk of harm. You haven't got to be wait till the shovel hits you. If you identify that you've been placed at potential risk of harm, straight away, whoever it is that's doing it has got to stop. Okay, how does that work? From doing that case, I realised that when once a potential risk of harm has been identified, something called a risk assessment should be produced. Now this is, people are now using risk assessments. I spoke to that ex-fireman earlier and he said, Rob, you're spot on with what you're saying. And I knew I was, but it's great to have it from him and other people. And this is why I'm using it. Okay. It doesn't define in the Act what harm is, it just says harm. It says health or safety. So what I realised is, and I'll wrap up in 5 minutes and we'll have a drink in that. What I realised is, placed in the potential risk of harm. So, let's have a look at it. In my friend's case, they did training properly, he got signed off sick and they did all sorts of health and safety issues. So I'm alright with that. But now I've adapted this because it's not, the Act's never changed, and they've not defined the words harm. And what I've realised is, when Mark Davinelli was saying about this natural, universal, or whatever you want to call it, is you do no harm. That's exactly what the health and safety that's in place is mirroring. But they've disguised it, and really it's above any law, it has to be. Because without that, there is nothing. They call it society, there's nothing. If you've not got... If you've not got an obligation to not cause harm, then what's the point of any doing fucking anything? We might as well just beat each other up, aren't we, and rob each other. But we don't do that, because we know it's not right. We treat other people like we want to be treated. So, potential risk of harm, health and safety is above law. It has to be, and all law follows it. So any corporation now contacting yourself, if they don't anymore, and appearing, there's nothing to say, I have to pay, but I've been helping people on this. Okay, because it doesn't define harm as specifically, a corporation, let's say, places a demand on you. Okay, the first thing is you identify that you're a potential risk of harm. Okay, let's say you're getting billed for $5,000. Right, if you've got it and you want to pay it, fine, pay it. You're not placing a potential risk of harm. Well, like I was saying when I was feeding my kids, I would place a potential risk of harm. That's why the copper said, throw that in the bin. I can't physically pay them, I haven't got it. I'm looking after the kids, I haven't got any money. I'm just barely keeping a roof above us and feeding us. So now I've been placed in a potential risk of harm things, but mainly for mortgages. I don't know if you know more, I don't know too many people in England that are using them, do they? It's not so successful over here, is it?
It's not as good over here, no, but it definitely works in Ireland.
Yeah.
It should work here.
It should work, shouldn't it? Let's say somebody's mortgage is €500 a month, I'll make it really quick, and they can't afford it, basically. What they do is they do like an expenditure sheet. They write everything they've got coming in and everything they've got to pay out, and whatever they're left with, let's just say they're left with €50 a month. That's all they can pay. Potential risk of harm, that's all they've got. I'm trying my best, I'm trying to perform on the contract, that's all I've got. It's not really a contract, but pretend it is. So what they do then is they make an official offer and send the payment to the building society or bank. Sometimes it's in the form of a cheque or you can money transfer. Once they've accepted that €50, that's it, your official offer's done. Okay, you never get your mortgage paid off until you start paying. But what you're telling them is, it's an economic shithole at the moment, I'm struggling. This is honest, and you have to do it properly. This is honestly all I've got, I cannot manage anymore. If things pick up, I'm going to pay more. But as now, this is my official offer, they've accepted payment, and then they have to carry on doing it. So I've known about this for quite a long time. Okay, last minute then, while I break. So, I start looking at, hang on, I've got a really good way of looking at something, and then looking at it from a completely different perspective. Apart from being a bit buzz-eyed sometimes, it works. Because I'm looking at it from their angle and from my angle. And then I thought, well, what is an official offer? Oh, just before that, hang on. You've got to do a risk assessment. Someone's got to provide a risk assessment. But coupled with a risk assessment is something called a RAMS. And it's a risk assessment method statement. And what that is how you arrived at that risk assessment, what steps you're going to take, what you think you should be doing. Remember, this is a potential risk of harm. This is what corporations should be doing for non-employees, like it says, but they don't. So we can do it. So coupled with a risk assessment, you're telling them, I mean, potential risk of harm, is a method statement, what will happen, how you've arrived at it. Okay. So those two things go together. So I start looking at, hang on, official offer, what is, without being blinkered and just thinking it's an official offer to pay a mortgage, and you can use it on loans and all sorts, what is an official offer? Well, it's a fucking risk assessment and a RAMS. It's the same thing. The risk assessment, you're saying to them, aren't you? I've only got €50 left, I can't do it. You're placing me at potential risk of harm. Me and my family are going to get kicked out onto the street. You're identifying the risk. By doing the expenditure sheet, what you've got coming in, that's your method statement. I can't afford it. I'm paying this out, I've got this, and this is all I've got left. So is not that an health and safety issue? So the reason it works, especially in Ireland, is you're adhering to health and safety, you're providing a risk assessment. Judge Rinder. Talking. He always hated when he was talking.
He's on the phone.
He's trying to tell me he's not gay. He's probably gay. He says he's got a wife, but I don't know. Yeah, so, risk assessment and method statement, and what I realised is I started adapting it, and it applies to everything. It applies to absolutely everything. There's a thing I want to talk about, I'm going to do about half an hour after break, and it's a thing called motu proprio from the Pope. Me and my mate Del have been killing people since the last 3 years on this, corporations. And I looked at motu proprio, and I'll go into a little bit more in a bit, but basically, because I know the Vatican's highest corporation on planet Earth, he's telling from motu proprio, which is issued by the Pope in his position as Supreme Pontiff, he's telling all officers of all corporations that if they no longer do right by people, they've no longer got any indemnity insurance. If they work, you can't be insured, in fact I got this from a friend's case, you can't be insured to do something wrong to someone, okay? You can only be insured to do something right. And so if they're harming someone, health and safety, all that stuff. If somebody in a corporation is harming someone, they must be working outside of their mandate, their scope of office. And what Pope Francis is saying, if you continue to do that any longer, you've no longer got any corporate insurance, and you're opening yourself up to become commercially liable personally. Now, I use motu proprio, and everybody shits themselves. I also use it with council tax. So, what is that, what the Pope's done? And he's done it on our behalf, and it's one of the most... It is a legal document, one of the most significant legal documents probably since Magna Carta, and I can't believe not enough people are using it. What is the motu proprio? It's a risk assessment and a method statement. And in the last half an hour, I'm going to show you that everything is a risk assessment and an effort statement. There's some other elements of tour and something called contribution negligence I want to talk about. But by the end of today, I hope you've got something out of it, because this really is a fantastic tool. And if nothing else, it will keep the wolf from the door. So what we're probably is telling all the CEOs, all the officers, do what you're supposed to be fucking doing now, because we're no longer going to cover you. And the reason doing it is, I think, and I don't know if you agree, I think the bad guys are going to be bailing out soon. And that's the only reason we've got this. I think they're going to bail out themselves and pull them in a different way. But anyway, once again, it's a risk assessment and an effort statement. So I'll leave it there, we'll have a break, and I'll finish off. Okay.
TV, in association with getoutofdebtfree.org.